which should be investigate allegation against her. So what Honorable Supreme Court on does not empower the Supreme Court to transfer the investigation from one state to the another. So the power under this section can only be used to transfer a case or appeal pending before a court to a court in another jurisdiction. So this CRPC, as we know today, that notified in 1974, way back in 1978, the Supreme Court in Ram Chandra Singh Sagar versus State of Tamil Nadu held that the move of the Supreme Court for the transfer of the FIR under section 406 of the CRPC amount to traveling the wrong street. So this has been a settled position of the law since then, and there are multiple judgments which caution the court against the ordinary interfering at the stage of investigation. So the Supreme Court has chimed and again held that investigation cannot be run at the behest of the accused. So Supreme Court has specifically stated that it is not on the convenient part of the accused that they will transfer the petition. So the accused has no choice in this manner in which she should be investigated. So the upturn the entire criminal machinery. Concerning the FIR, in the instant case in Mumbai, no FIR has been registered yet, and the Mumbai police has neither considered the matter under section 175 sub clause 2 of the CRPC, suspecting the commission of the cognizable offence, nor proceeded for the registration of an FIR under section 154 or referred the matter under section 157 of the CRPC or to the nearest magistrate at the jurisdiction. So at this point, the decision of the apex court in the Manoj K. Sharma versus State of Chhattisgarh was taken. Court was of the opinion that investigation on an inquiry under section 174 of the code is a distinct from the investigation as contemplated under section 154 of the code relating to the commission of the cognizable offence. So in the present case, the Mumbai police has done nothing except attempt to stretch the purview of section 174 without drawing up any FIR. So they are yet to be registered in FIR, so nor they have made any suitable determination in the term of section 175 sub clause 2 of the CRPC. So there is no question of the parallel investigation being carried out by the Mumbai police. So the trend concerning the transfer of the cases, similar view has been expressed in Narmada Bai versus State of Gujarat and Sanjeev Rajendra Bhatt versus Union of India and Divine Retract Center versus State of Kerala. Therefore, the petition seeking the transfer of investigation from Patna to Mumbai under section 406 of the CRPC is untenable in the view of the text of section 406 CRPC. So Ram Chandra Singh judgment and other judgment mentioned here, and at best the petitioner, the petition under section under article 32 of the constitution could have been entertained. So case heard by the single judge. Another interesting aspect of the case in this power of the single judge. The Supreme Court amended its own rule, 2013 rule, recently May 2020, and notified that the single judge can hear the application seeking the transfer of the case and not transfer of the investigation. So also it will be interesting to see if the two judges bench decision in Ram Chandra case is deemed to be binding on the single judge. So what is the conclusion as per my concern? Having a regard to the earlier precedent, the statutory provision, court held that the Patna police committed no illegality in registering the complaint. It also held that looking at the nature of the allegation in the complaint, which also relate to the misappropriation and the breach of the trust. So the exercise of the jurisdiction by the Bihar police apparent to be the order, and at the stage of investigation, police is not required to transfer the FIR. So for the same reason, the Bihar government was competent to give the consent for the entrustment of the investigation to the CBI, and such the ongoing investigation by the CBI was held to be unlawful. The accused advocates that this is going to prejudice the justice, because it is the Supreme Court has to give a justice to the appellant who has filed an appeal to the Supreme Court. So to this, I am ending this my session, and I am handing this session to advocate on record, Pallavi Pratap, who is having wide practical knowledge, because he is also present when this argument was there. So I am handing this session to ma'am. So ma'am, it is to you, ma'am.
Thank you. So basically, I am also now thinking, what should I speak, because you've covered everything. But nonetheless, I will actually just speak out the important points that I wanted to, and then maybe we can open it up for discussion if there are questions that people have. then we can look at, you know, maybe answering them in 5-10 minutes. So I will not basically be taking a lot of time in terms of speaking. Now, surrender and all of that is now being heard by chamber judge in who's sitting singularly. It is not a division bench anymore. It's a single judge bench. And Justice Hrishikesh Roy is known to be a very, very balanced judge. So one cannot say that, you know, he can show any attribution of bias or anything. Extremely balanced judge. And I remember the arguments kept going on for a very long time from everybody's side. But, you know, the way he dealt with it, that is also very clear from the judgment that he's written. And even though maybe you might say that the fourth issue that he made, as far as the judgment was concerned, he's probably not answered it in so many words that one would have wanted him to, because he's kind of silent as far as like the fourth issue is concerned. I'll come on the issues just now. But I feel that, you know, otherwise he's trying to satisfy everybody in terms of all the stakeholders, so to say, in order to give a quietus to this, you know, the controversy that's suddenly arose. Now, I might be repetitive, so everybody, if they can bear with me for a little bit, that would be really nice. So like we all know, Riya Chakrabarty had actually filed this transfer petition, which was under section 406 of CRPC, and was basically transfer of an FIR from Patna to Mumbai. Like you said, and like Sagar said, we've typically seen that it is cases which are transferred from one, you know, jurisdiction to another. So it could be a matrimonial case. It could be, and typically, I'm thinking transfer petitions are typically covered, are filed every second day, and they are mostly, you know, matrimonial cases. So if let's say the girl has then has gone and started to live with the parents in some other state and the boy is living in some other state, for example, most of the times we see that the boy is probably residing in Gurgaon or Noida, working over there, and the girl is probably from UP, Bihar or the Hindi belt. So she's gone back to her parents, and so she's filed all the DD cases, etc., over there, wherever she's residing. So one typically exercises transfer petitions in that kind of a scenario. And in my experience, and what I have seen is that typically when you have a transfer petition, you get a notice issued when the other side comes. In a matrimonial proceeding, there will be a mediation which will be done. And mostly I've seen that, you know, under 142, if a solution is found in terms of both the parties agreeing to take a divorce, then under 142, the judges sitting in DB will give divorce also to the you know, to the parties who are there. So these things we've seen in 142, but we've seen 142 being exercised by a division bench. I think this is for the first time that an exercise of a plenary power that the judge has, a single judge has actually exercised this. This, and I think this is where the entire conflict and so much noise is being made as to whether or not a single judge can exercise that power or not. So actually moving forward, I just very quickly take everybody through what was the submission looking like and what did the different lawyers submit, so that, you know, one can actually make out exactly what was the contention of everybody. Now, like you said, Shyam Divan sir was representing Riya Chakrabarty, and the entire matter was, of course, relating to the unnatural death, or unnatural because it is still at investigation stage, so it is also not correct for me to say that it is an unnatural death. But the unnatural death of actor Sushant Singh Rajput at his residence, which is in Mumbai, which comes under the Bandra police station. And if there is an unnatural death that takes place, then the procedure is that under 174 CRPC, you know, the case gets reported. So it is a provision under 174 CRPC which is there, and it is only after investigation that the police can file an FIR looking at whether or not there is a case of unnatural death that can be made out. Now, the actress was represented by Shyam Devansar, like I said. She was in a live-in relationship. We all know, I think, every day we get so much news about her, which is coming in. So she was in a live-in relationship, but she left on the 8th of June, like she's contended. And she moved back to her house, and she said that, you know, in the transfer petition, she said that, you know, we've all watched that video of hers where she's, you know, holding hands and saying he's for CBI, for investigation, tweet, Amit Shah, all of that. But primarily, the transfer that she asked for was for the investigation to be transferred from Bihar to Mumbai, saying that, you know, this investigation primarily because Bihar does not have jurisdiction, because most of the things have happened under the jurisdiction of Bandra Police, therefore it should be transferred to Bandra Police. Now, she further said that the incidents that were alleged in the FIR, like I said, have taken place entirely under the jurisdiction of state of Maharashtra, therefore the complaint should have been forwarded to Mumbai for further investigation instead of the Bihar Police taking care of it. And also she submitted was that the mere factor of complainant being a resident of Patna did not really confer on him, you know, the confer the jurisdiction on Bihar Police. This is the long and short of their argument. But one of the most important part of their argument was that the consent that Bihar government gave for CBI to conduct investigation would not be considered as a lawful consent under Section 6 of the Delhi Special Police Act, under which the CBI operates. So this was the long and short of Mr. Devan's argument. Now, the state of Bihar was represented, like you said, by Manohar Singh Sir, and he submitted that since it was a cognizable offence, therefore it was incumbent for Patna Police to register the case, because if it was a non-cognizable offence, then maybe they could have just taken up a complaint. So the whole factor of, you know, politics influencing it for there being pressure was not the correct argument, and that there are allegations of criminal breach of trust, there are allegations of cheating, there are allegations of transfer of money from the account of deceased to Riya Chakrabarty's account, and primarily the consequences of the offence which are projected, they actually took place within the jurisdiction of Bihar, so therefore Bihar Police should have the right to conduct investigation. Now, it was also further said that Mumbai Police was only, like I told you in before also, that Mumbai Police was only conducting inquiry into the unnatural death of the actor under Section 174 CRPC. And therefore, Mumbai Police was not empowered to undertake any investigation of the complaint lodged in Bihar. And the fact that, you know, the SP of Bihar Police goes to Mumbai and he is put into quarantine, there is absolutely no cooperation which was given, and there was obstruction, as has been alleged, that Mumbai Police was obstructing. Therefore, it was pertinent that there was some kind of, fishy behavior that one could see, and that is the reason why an FIR was not registered in Mumbai, it was registered in Bihar. And therefore, when the consent was given by Bihar government under Section 6 of Delhi Special Police Act, it was actually completely correct process. And also, Mr. Maninder Singh had added that, you know, because Riya Chakrabarty was herself asking for, investigation to be conducted by CBI, the transfer petition had anyway become infructuous. Because she herself said that, you know, you transfer it to CBI, there was no such thing as a transfer from one state to another, and there was an adjudication only to the limited point of whether or not CBI can investigate. Therefore, the transfer petition had become infructuous. This was the argument that Manohar Singh Sir had said. Now, then comes father, and he contended that it, basically the arguments remained the same. Again, the 174 CRPC came into figure, and but one of the things that he said was that, you know, the misappropriation of the asset which was alleged, which is basically the important points that have been mentioned in the FIR, this happened as far as Bihar was concerned. Why? Because the father is the class 1 heir of the deceased, and therefore the action of Patna police was, you know, completely within the jurisdiction of 179 read with 181.4 of CRPC, which if you would know 181.4 of CRPC completely speaks of consequences ensuing at another place. So therefore the registration of FIR by Bihar police was completely in line. Then comes your state of Maharashtra. State of Maharashtra was represented by Dr. Singhvi, Dr. Abhishek Manu Singhvi, and he contended that police registered an accidental death report and commenced inquiry under section 174. And their role primarily was to ascertain the cause of death and whether death was as a result of criminal act committed by some other person. So if it was, the first step for them was to ascertain whether or not suicide took place. And if it was not suicide, then who are those people that we can look at who were responsible for the murder that has taken place? Now, Bombay police had recorded statement of some 56 people and had also relied on post-mortem report. They also had forensic report. The other, important contention of the thing we raised, and I'm sure a lot of you lawyers who are practicing would also agree with me that, there could have been a registration of a zero FIR. This is something that we've naturally seen so many times happen. I mean, in Delhi, it happens very often when, there is a jurisdiction dispute as far as, because Delhi has a border which is very porous in terms of Gurgaon, in terms of Noida. So, there are so many instances of zero FIRs being registered just because of the jurisdiction issue. And that if a zero FIR was registered by Bihar police, then the transfer of the investigation could have taken place and the Mumbai police could have investigated. Why I'm telling you all of these contentions is because these are different arguments that have been used. Now, tomorrow as practicing lawyers, if we ever have a situation, then we can always look at these arguments, you know, to affirm our case when we are arguing before different courts. So, so coming back to zero FIR, now if this registration of complaint gets permitted, you know, for example, that if Bihar police is registering an entire case which it seems falls in the jurisdiction of Maharashtra, this is going to open up a Pandora's box. Because what is going to happen is that everybody will then start doing similar practices. Wherever you feel that the investigating agency is not going to be favorable, go and file your FIR into some other jurisdiction, because there you might be able to influence the investigating agency, or maybe you would have a better approach, so to say. But this is then, what is this going to lead to? This is going to lead to what we lawyers have always seen, something called as forum hunting. That, if this forum is not working, let's go to that forum and then get a favorable order. Multiple proceedings which are emanating out of the same cause of action. Now, this was the contention that Dr. Singhvi had raised, that, this is then only going to look like you are just shopping for a favorable investigating agency. Then he also said that the allegations which are made in the FIR, these were not made in the statement that was appeared, the Government Solicitor General, and he submitted that Maharashtra Police did not register any FIR and was only conducting a limited inquiry under Section 174 of CRPC. And then he submitted that